Welcome, I'm Frederik. Today I will be talking about the current situation. I will be talking about how to make sure that your company is as stable as possible, how to leverage on the opportunities that you do have during this situation. I'll be talking about how to make your team, your staff, your employees more resilient as humans so they can easier go through this crisis. And then I'll be talking about how do we prepare for what I call the new normal. After the crisis here, something new is coming for sure, and we have to make sure that we get out of this stronger and ready to cope with it. Hi. Well, this is just a last minute change that we did to this presentation. We've added a special section at the very end of the presentation where we cover how do we handle crisis communication with the media, with our investors, with our customers and other stakeholders. So make sure that you watch everything to the very end, because we'll be touching about how do we actually communicate with our stakeholders during this situation. So enjoy the presentation, and I'll see you from my home office at the very end again. Allow me to give you a brief introduction to me. I'm born in Denmark in 1973. The last 7 years I've been working in the Middle East for some of the largest insurers in the MENA region. Currently I'm with Noor Takaful, where I'm overseeing the company's strategy development and digital transformation. Besides working for Noor Takaful, I am head of the MENA region for the Digital Insurer, which is the world's largest knowledge base of digital insurance. I'm also a lecturer in the world's first MBA on digital insurance. Prior to that, I was running the worldwide operations for the world's largest emergency assistance provider, SOS International, based out of Europe, but my primary time was in the air, flying around to our 43 offices all over the world. Let me give you an overview of what I think the situation is here and now. Right now, we are in a situation where, to quote Winston Churchill, we may have seen the end of the beginning. And I base that on China has successfully stopped the outbreak, at least at the moment of recording this, of more cases. That tells me that there may be a time coming now where you'll see less cases in China. I cannot see that development in the rest of the world yet, but my hope is that if China, they found a way of containing this, then the rest of the world will follow after some time. However, and this is important for me, is you have to be cautious here, because just because China is finding their way out of this now doesn't mean that the rest of the world hasn't seen the worst of it. I think we still, as I'm recording this, have to see a larger scale of outbreaks. So we have to embrace for that. The positive point is that if China, they found a way of containing it, then it will come to us as well. So this is the light at the end of the tunnel for me. So if we're looking at what's happening, then I would actually say that we are witnessing a paradigm shift. And the paradigm shift is coming, of course, in the way that we are working, in the way that our colleagues are working, in the way that we are forced to work from home. It's been popular to allow employees to work from home for quite some time now, and the number of people with the gig economy and the consulting economy has slowly increased. But now, all of a sudden, in a very, very short time period, all of us are working from home. And I think apart from just turning our worlds upside down immediately, it's also giving us a new normal, a new everyday that we have to prepare for. We'll see disruptions in our supply chains. We'll see disruptions in our finances. We'll see disruptions in the way that we work with our customers. There's so many areas who have changed to something completely new that the world has not experienced before, at least not in our lifetimes. So for me, what's most important is, first of all, to make sure that the business that you're running is stabilized, is stable, or as stable as it can be. I know this is very difficult in a situation we haven't tried before, but there are some precautionary measures that you should take right away if you haven't done so already. I would suggest forming a series of teams to take care of the well-being of the organization as such. One of the teams, which should be cross-functional because this involves everybody, should have the responsibility of making sure that people are feeling as good as possible. This is a high-stress situation, so people, they will be stressed. They will be extremely worried about their future, about their families, their friends, relatives, and their jobs. It's important that you set up a team that actually deals with this. On the same side, you have to make a cross-functional team that take care of the financials. The financials are no longer just the finance department, because you have to take care of getting money from customers. You have to take care of paying suppliers, taking care of your relations with the banks, with everybody in your ecosystem. Everybody will be very, very strained for cash and probably experience very significant cash flow interruptions. So you have to make sure that you're doing what you can to secure a stable cash flow for your company. This goes directly into the supply chain. If you're running a company that is extremely important of materials from your supply chain, you have to have a team only taking care of this. In the insurance industry, this is not as important because the assets are digital or can be made digital. So we're not in the insurance industry as depending on deliveries from suppliers that other industries are. And lastly, you should set up a team. If you haven't done, you most probably have. You should have a team that takes care of the virtual working. So people, they are actually capable or able to work from home. And this is an important point because there's a difference in are you able to work from home and are you capable of working from home? The thing is, when we've been working from home, you know, once or twice per month, it's one thing. We maybe haven't been that concentrated, and maybe some of us had taken it as a day off, but now it's a full-time working from home, and your team has to be able to learn the new normal. How do we actually do this? How do we make ourselves available in front of the computer? How do we deliver on the projects that we have to deliver on? You need a team to take care of that your employees are all capable to work from home. Successfully running the business, in my opinion, requires that the leaders, they give up authority. Because all of a sudden, when you are at this completely dispersed workforce, you cannot rely on all decisions coming back to the leaders, because they will also be dealing with all other issues during this crisis. So as leaders, you will have to delegate authority to the people so they can make decisions faster, and you will avoid significant business interruptions just because you're waiting for somebody to approve something that others in principle easily could have approved. As a leader, you have to understand and appreciate that everybody is looking to you. If you're running around looking scared and nervous, everybody, they will be very nervous and very scared. You have to be confident, and you have to be confident in a way where you are signaling, yes, this is a very serious situation. We are taking it serious. I know the way for us to handle it. I don't think you can tell that you know the way out of it or you know what's going to happen, but you can say, as far as I know, we have things under stable control. Also reference to the four groups I was talking about just before. You have to keep some sense of optimism. If you're running around and saying everything's going to be fine, nobody's going to believe you. But you still have to be able to see the light at the end of the tunnel. You have to be able to show the people that you're working with that there is a way out of it. We are doing this, we're growing stronger, and we do this together, and we will fix it together. That goes to the last point, because yes, you have to be optimistic, but you also have to be realistic. I think at this point, everybody, they know that there'll be massive layoffs. And if you're just running around being optimistic, saying everything's going to be fine, nobody will believe you anyway. So you have to be honest. Yes, we will have issues with our cash flows. Yes, we will have issues with our suppliers, with our vendors, everybody, with our customers. So we will have to look at how we're organized. And yes, it will probably cause people to lose their jobs. You have to be honest about it. And you have to be honest about how you will help the people that you have to let go move on. All this being said, I think it's time to look at how can we leverage on the current situation. Because there are some fantastic opportunities to change the way the organization works. Most organizations have a legacy of processes and ways of working that are just that because that's what we used to do, and not necessarily the smartest way. Now, when people are away and we cannot move paper around anymore, everything more or less has to be digital. When you start doing things digitally, why not look at the way that you do it, the process that you do it? So I would suggest one of the things that you can do now is take a good hard look at your processes in the organization and say, okay, this guy is a little cumbersome. Why don't we straighten it out and make a new process digitally enabled to make this workflow much, much faster? This is a huge opportunity. Look at your processes as they are today. Get a cross-functional team again to write them down, understand it, and then brainstorm how can we actually make that one straight line, and what digital tools can we use, what workflow management tools can we use to help us. Another really important opportunity that you have now, and this follows also the processes and the layoffs that I was talking about before, is maybe now is the time to break down the silos that you have in your organization. Especially if you're in the financial services industry, you will have a long and proud history of having silos. This is my area, this is your area, this is my area, don't you touch my area. Now, with the new processes, with the new way of working, with your teams taking care of people cross-functional, maybe now's the time to tear down the silos. And you have to lay off people. I cannot think of many industries where this is not necessary. So think about reorganizing everything. When you get your experiences from how do we redesign our new processes, then how would that reflect into organizational culture? A typical way companies are doing this is they're changing the silo ownership to a process ownership. So when you create new processes, for example, a customer introduction process, then there's an owner for that process that goes across the various units. And this is how they structure the organization going forward. So to me, it's extremely serious and it's a bad situation. It will cause a lot of tragedies and it will cost a lot of jobs. And this is just very bad. I also, as I've said, we have to find a way of getting something positive out of it when we're looking at our businesses and how we run our business, and also preparing our business for the future. A very important point, if not the most important point, is of course the people that will help us build that business of the future. And right now, these people are worried and scared and uncertain about their future. We will have to deal with that very seriously. We will have to deal with how the people feel, how it affects them working from home and not having this daily physical contact. I'm very proud to introduce no other person than my own father to talk about this subject. He's been running business psychology businesses and private psychology businesses very successfully in Europe for the last 35 years. He's been establishing his own psychological crisis management company. So he knows about human crisis. He knows about how humans are behaving and he knows about how to create resilience in times like this. So let's change the scene and go talk to him. The human mind is extremely powerful. The human mind is the reason that the human race is where we are today. It's also an extremely fragile instrument that we have to take care of. And we know from history that when we are in stressful situations, the human mind can wander and become very destructive. So an extremely important part of getting through this crisis is to take care of your mind, take care of yourself. And that's why I'm so happy to have you here, because we're going to talk about now human resilience. How do you create a stronger mind capable of coping with this crisis that we are in?
I totally agree with your words about the fragility of the mind. A crucial part to be a human being is being part of a community. You could say that who are you really if nobody sees you and respond on you? Primitive cultures have known that for many, many years. Just think about for a moment how so-called primitive cultures outlaw some of the members of the society. The outlaws left the society, left the community, went into the forest or into the bush and died. An existence outside the community was not an option, wasn't possible. And it's quite interesting that our modern societies are no different. Lots of studies show that our human immune system really is endangered when we live too long in loneliness.
That's quite a grave picture to paint in a situation where we're actually forced to live in loneliness or isolation. So but what you're saying is if we don't take this very seriously and try to find a way of getting human contact, then we actually may have serious problems.
Yes, you're quite right. We have serious problems. Of course, our immune system is not endangered overnight because we are alone for a weekend or so. But here we are talking, in worst case, about months, maybe more months. And for many people, it'll be the result can be, I would almost say, catastrophic. Some social researchers have started to think about what's going to happen. And some of them are using very strong words. They are saying that the sum of social pain resulting from this crisis will be, and then they use the word gigantic. So we are really up to something. We really have to do something actively about it. Luckily, we can do something about it by acting. We cannot totally remove it, but we can do something.
So tell us, what can we do? We are obviously, we know that we have to stay mentally strong also after the crisis. So we need something to do right now. What can that be?
Traditional as it might light, sound, get in good shape.
So physically get
physical,
out
and get in good
stay home and get in good shape.
Yes, yeah. Because there's a very close connection between your mind and your physics. The stronger you are physical, the more resilience, seen from a mental point of view, do you have. So one of the first points is see to that you get in good condition physically.
So that's go to YouTube and find workout from home videos. Yeah.
Yes.
And what else to do?
Yes, what else? Another thing that's very important, and it's more important that you than you maybe would think from the first point of view, is to make to see to that you have daily routines in your everyday life.
Just like normal when you go to work, you get up and you get dressed and you go to work. That's the routine.
So exactly, yes.
We have to keep that.
Yes, do exactly as you are used to. Mm. Get up at the same time as you did when you left for work. Take breaks through the day at the same times. Take a walk at the times you normally did that, or at the times when you went to the gym or whatever. But the daily routines are very, very important. If you go to people who are who have experienced this on their own situation, it could be submarine crews, it could be seamen on container ships, and it could also be nuns for that sake, then they all stress the importance about the daily routines to avoid disintegration of the day. Mm-hmm. So that's a very important point.
And what about, now we cannot have physical contact, but what about visual contact with video and virtual meetings? Is that something that's important to remember as well?
Yes, it is important to see each other. The most important, the best would be, of course, if you could meet as you used to at the water cooler or the coffee machine, but that's not possible now. The good thing with water cooler and coffee machine are that when you're standing there, you can read the whole body language of your colleague or whoever is there. On a video, however good it might be, you can only normally only see the vision of the face and often we also are a little stiff when we are presented before such a video. But you are quite right. Okay. The more video, the better.
So we have to have our daily Friday afternoon bar on video, huh?
Yes, but exactly.
It's better exactly. than nothing, of course, much yes. better. Are there any other things here at the end that you'd like to add to how to build that human resilience, preparing for what's coming next?
Yes, we are still in moving around and general advices, and I have a couple of general advices more here. One of them is, again, very basic and simple. Resume your hobbies or get a new hobby, because it's a very good way to get your thoughts, your periods away from the crisis and reload whole your system.
I know, actually, now we are actually living here in isolation together, and now you've started playing guitar.
Yeah, that's right. Yes, that's right. A dream from my childhood come true now in this situation, yes. And then, of course, a thing that's evident, you have to follow the crisis, the development of the crisis at authoritative medias, and of course do what the authorities ask you to do, follow the rules.
But this is the thing, and maybe this is one of my pet peeves, because I have colleagues who are reading everything. And everything, and if you read everything, there's enough bad news to make you really worried. Would you suggest that you tone down and not read so much, or should you follow everything?
Yeah, absolutely. I would suggest that you find some authoritative medias. If I should mention one just now, I could mention many, but one of them could be The Guardian. Read The Guardian every day, and then you do not need to read about the crisis any other places. I would like so much that many of the big companies made their own information channel about this. It would be a good idea for the company. It would send some good signals about taking care of the people and so on. And also the employees had one place to go, a curated place that guaranteed the value of the news.
So people shouldn't read everything, right? Because a lot of it is just exaggerated and a lot of maybe even fake news. So stick to one news source. And this is also a good idea to the companies, right? If you can create one news source that is credible, that is curated, and ask your employees to only read that, because then they wouldn't be bothered reading all kinds of, you know, maybe even fake news, but disturbing news, and can focus on keeping mentally healthy. Any other things that we should be aware of?
Yes, you could say these general advices aside, then you can take your thoughts away from the crisis and get to other matters. And there are a couple of things I would suggest you to do. One of the very important things, I should say, everything I say here is important, because we have had to prioritize. But one of the important things is to ensure as much and as good contact with family, friends, and colleagues. It could be a good idea to make a scheme to write down who you would contact when and using which kind of media, so you are sure to get all the way around. But it cannot be stressed too much that this contact, for many people, the only contact they have to other human beings in this situation, it's so important. So do that. This crucial contact to other people is important. One of the most important reasons is that the talk to others and the meet with others on the internet is an antidote, can be seen as an antidote to some symptoms, some boredom, decreased concentration, insomnia, feeling alone, and so on. So it's more important than you can imagine to do that. And therefore, I feel it's necessary to say that if you are not competent on the social media, see to get it, because you have to use social media in this time here.
So basically, what you're saying, if you don't have many people to call, you should actually get out, getting to know more people using social media, so you have more people to speak with.
Yeah.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. Finding friends on social media. Anything else?
Yes, there's one thing that is rather close to my heart I would like to mention. I know I mentioned it some time earlier, but let me do it again. If you want to go a little deeper in your own understanding of how you react to the crisis and to the loneliness as a result of the crisis, it can be a good idea to lean back, sit down, grab a pencil and a piece of paper, and note down how you are feeling, what you are thinking about all this. Make some notes, and then after that, make a creative expression of your thoughts and feelings. It can be a drawing, it can be a painting, it can be a piece of music or a poem. But do that, and if you do that, you do not have to think very much about it. But if you do that, you can avoid that those unrecognized thoughts and feelings disturb your everyday. So you could, so to speak, say that's a kind of antidote to the unconscious going and interfering in your daily day. And here, as on many other things we've been talking about, it would be a very good idea to talk with others about it. You can, one of the friends you are talking with or family you are contacting via video, you can show them your drawing or read up your poet to them and just listen and let them say something to it. And you will find out that your communication has been more deep than before, and that'll also be a good thing in this period where we are so isolated as we are.
Thank you very much. That was a lot of food for thought, but actually more than just food for thought, it's things that we have to start doing and take very seriously to keep our minds healthy. So I hope you enjoyed this, and thank you again for volunteering for this.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, welcome back. I hope you enjoyed this about how to create human resilience and get a deeper understanding of how people actually react. And I also hope you got some takeaways for what you should do when you go back to your company, or you turn this conference off and actually start talking virtually with your employees and colleagues. Let's have a look at how you increase your own company's resilience and preparing it for the new normal, for the future, for what's coming after this. One thing that I think you must understand right away is that no matter what, we'll be looking into a new normal. The world has changed, and when it comes back to a stable state, it'll be a normal that we haven't seen before. This is extremely important for me to underline. The new world that we'll see will be much more digitized than it is today. It will be much more virtual in the sense that people all of a sudden have been used to working 100% digitally together. It will be a world with much shorter decision cycles, because when you are running in a long-term crisis situation, then you know if you make slow decisions, you're dead. So most of the successful companies, they will have much shorter decision cycles. Organization as such will be more agile. I think the new normal will involve in teams-based organizations instead of structured, hierarchical organizations. And we will also see that strategy is no longer something you do for 3 years. Strategy is something you do for 3 months. And then you re-evaluate 3 months, or maybe even shorter cycles. These are some of the things that I see a new normal will be. So how do you prepare for this new normal that's coming up? Well, you can use the classical start, stop, continue, which I've made here. And let me just go through some of the points that I think are important for you to be aware of. First of all, you should start planning for the end of the crisis. If you start planning for the end of the crisis the day it's over, you're already too late. You have to prepare now so the day that hopefully soon the crisis is over or almost over, then you're ready to hit the ground running. Then you know what you want to do. You know how you want to rebuild your company and start moving forward fast. So hopefully you can re-employ some of the people that you had to let go during the crisis. It follows from what I said before that the organization that you have to create must be much more simple than it is today. Base it on teams, loose structures, much faster decision cycles, delegation of authority. Create an organization that is easy to understand and easy to be in and easy to make changes to and with. You should already now start reskilling people if you haven't done so. Reskilling them in virtual meetings, reskilling in digital tools, digital competences, because the world will be digital. The new normal will be online. So you have to make sure that your people and your systems are ready for this. I would say accelerate your digital transformation if you can by any means. For the things that you have to stop doing, stop thinking that yesterday will be tomorrow after this crisis. Stop believing that things will go back to what it was before. It will not. Just throw it out of the window. Everything has changed and you have to find your place in that new normal. So stop thinking or hoping that it'll be back to what it was before. It also follows what I've been saying, that you should stop any unnecessary bureaucracy in your company. Reduce all these decisions and memos that are not necessary to make people able to make faster decisions. Take a look at all your projects and say, how many of these projects are actually adding value to what we're doing? And if they're not adding value, kill them. Kill your darling projects if they're not adding value. Find the projects that are supporting the new future and up-prioritize them. And of course, but this goes without saying, find your unneeded spend and eliminate it. And eliminate more than you think you should. And I don't think you'll need to have that spend again once we're back to the new normal. So you might as well cut it now and save that money. You should, of course, continue to take care of your people. These are your most valuable assets. So continue to do what you're doing now to make sure that they feel as safe as they can in the current environment. You should continue focusing on your customers. Of course, this is where you get your money, so this is your priority number one. You should also continue focusing on your key projects. It makes little sense stopping these key projects now just to find out that you have to restart them in 3 months from now. So make them continue in any way possible. And relentlessly understand how your people are working from home. Continue to find new ways of improving their work from home conditions. Teach them, give them programs, learning, coaching in how do we do virtual? How do we cope with being isolated from the people that we're used to seeing every day? An interesting exercise that you can do also to find out where is your place in the new world is to sit with your management team or your strategy team or your colleagues, whoever, and talk about what are our core competences. What were they yesterday? What are they right now? And where do they need to be in the new normal for us to be successful? Core competences are typically 3 or 4 different things. It is your technology, your tech architecture. It is the skills and knowledge that you have in your organization. And it's your management systems. All these systems are being bound together by the values of your people. They're being bound together by the values of your people. You have to take care of your people. Your people is make or break in this. But go back, take a step back, take a look at, do we have any core competences in our tech architecture, in our management systems, the way that we do business, target operating models, if you like? Do we have skills and knowledge that only we have or we are only using in a way that other people are not? And are all these things coming to the market through the values that we want, through the values that our people have? Now's a good time to re-examine this and put a path toward how do we develop ourselves for the new normal, for the new future. A way of ensuring that your new or adjusted core competences actually get launched into the market in a fast and effective manner is to build on the principles for an agile organization. Create a very, very clear North Star for the company, for the teams in your company, and say, this is where we want to go, this is what we believe in, and these are the targets and the measurements that we will take to get there. Build an organizational structure based on squads or teams, so who are empowered to choose their own way towards the North Star. Make sure that each team has their own targets, but that they set these targets themselves so they feel the responsibility for moving their area towards the guiding North Star. Enable everybody to learn fast and make decisions fast. I know I've said this many times, but this is so important. Make sure that people, they get upskilled or reskilled so they can actually deliver what's required in this new normal. Make sure that you don't have to wait unnecessary for decisions. These teams have to move fast. This is a digital new world we're talking about. Things are not waiting for anything. It's just moving blisteringly fast. You need to have an organization who's capable of following that. Build your future on next-gen technology. See if it's possible for you to jump an evolutionary step so you go from what you have today to what is even more advanced, so you don't have to take that step. Look at out-of-the-box solutions. How can you connect a lot of simple systems so you create a technology system that is what you're needing? And of course, last of all, make sure that the people that are working with you, they are passionate about what they're doing. A way of making passionate and motivated people are actually engaging them in these empowered teams that I spoke about before. All these things will help you put together an organization that are ready to change towards the new normal. And if you jump into the new normal and you find it wasn't exactly what you expected it to be, then if you have an agile organization, you can roll back or roll out and roll somewhere else and very, very quickly respond to the market. So where does that leave us right now? Well, I think first of all, make sure that your organization is as stable as possible in the current scenario. This is number one. If you don't have a foundation that is fairly strong to step on, then everything else is useless or void. Make sure that the people that work around you are taken care of, that they feel as safe and confident as possible, because you need them to build the future, to be resilient during the crisis. Get a proper project overview. This is more important than you think. Get an overview of all projects going on in your company, all small, big, whatever. We did this recently in my company, and we're not a very big company, but we had 73 ongoing projects in 4 different departments only. And that means people, they are unfocused. They don't know which project to prioritize, which leads to number 4. Prioritize the projects. Find the projects that are supporting your digital transformation, that are supporting what you believe is going to be the new normal. These are the projects you want to prioritize and kill everything else. I hope you enjoyed listening to me and my father. I hope you learned something new. I hope I gave you some inspiration to what to do next. I hope you now see that, yes, we are in a situation that we need to deal with, but we also need to deal with what's coming after, because there will be something after, and we have to make sure we are as strong as possible when this new normal is coming. Welcome back. I hope you found the presentation interesting. I know that I learned a lot when I listened to my father, because there are so many things that you're not aware of in these situations. So hopefully you liked it. Now, let's talk about how you communicate with the external and internal stakeholders during this situation, because most of us are in a situation we're not used to. We don't know how do we actually relate to this. How do we manage our investors, our owners? How do we manage our stakeholders, the media, our customers? So let me give you a few tips to how you can prepare and what you have to do in order to stay credible, in order to avoid too much negative press around your company. The first step that I would suggest that you do is to map a comprehensive, exhaustive list of the stakeholders that you do have. This is typically your owners, your board of directors, customers, partners, suppliers, employees, of course, and media. Everybody in your environment, in your ecosystem that have a say or an influence in your business or how your business is perceived. Map them all down. I would then suggest that you do a 3-step information strategy. The first step is to be very clear about the severity of the impact from this crisis. And typically, because we don't know it yet, typically I would suggest that you do three different scenarios. A worst case scenario, how is your organization, how your company going to look if everything just goes the worst possible way? You can, on the other side of the spectrum, have a best case scenario. How will things go and look if everything stops tomorrow and we are capable of resuming business? And then your most likely scenario, how do you think as a manager that your company will end out of this crisis? Based on your three scenarios, you could then create a mitigation plan, saying now we know that these are the scenarios, we have an idea of how it will impact our business. So these are the things we will do now, tomorrow, and in the future to mitigate the consequences of the scenarios. I would also here suggest that you do a kind of staging on if this then. You can say if this happens during the crisis, then we will do this. If the crisis becomes even worse, we will start plan B or plan C, which are all these things. Because then when you communicate with the stakeholders, you also give them the confidence that you know what you're doing and you've planned for various scenarios to happen. These are, of course, the heavy news, because most of the time this would be about letting people go, cutting costs. So most of this will be bad news. You would probably do good by ending this presentation and this talk with, okay, how do we leverage the crisis? How do we build something strong out of this crisis? So when it's over, we are ready to hit the ground running. When it's over, we are a strong company ready to face the new challenges that will be in the market. Then I would suggest that you meet all your stakeholders virtually. Face to face is possible, because when you are looking at people, you can see their reactions, you can see their thoughts, and you get a feeling of how they react to what you're telling them. People presence is so very important when you're communicating bad news. So to the greatest extent possible, make sure that you ask people to turn on the video so you can see them as well. And of course, it goes without saying, you have to turn your video on as well. For the presentation or for the communication, anticipate hard questions. It's always a crisis situation where you have to let people go and cut costs. So anticipate a lot of hard questions. The best way of doing this is actually thinking about what hard questions would you ask if somebody was telling you bad news about another company. Anticipate the questions. A great way of anticipating or preparing for these questions is to prepare a one-pager. A one-pager where you can write down your three-step tactics that we discussed just before, where you will answer some of the anticipated questions. And this one-pager you can even send out beforehand to your stakeholders, or you can set out after your meeting. But it will help you get things in writing, and it will help you to have a consistent communication across all your channels, but also across all stakeholder groups. When you're presenting this, don't fall into the trap and get into fights with people. I know it's hard taking harsh questions and being blamed for doing things wrong, but you will not make things better by starting to defend yourself. Listen to people. Let them finish their grievances. Let them finish their frustrations. Acknowledge that you hear them, and then give an objective and quiet answer. If you start escalating the situation, I'm certain that you will be the one losing, because you will just give yourself and your company an even worse image. I would also suggest you to over-communicate. Even smaller things, communicate to everybody. Let them know that you're aware of the situation. Let them know that you're working on it. Let them know that you have it under control. Do you know what you're doing? You have to show them that level of confidence. You have to show them that this is a fantastically hard situation. I know what I'm doing. Every day I'm assessing the situation, doing whatever I can, given the new information. You cannot over-communicate in this situation. You simply cannot. It's a tough situation, and it is now leaders, they have to get in front, they have to be open and honest, they have to take all the hard decisions, take all the hard dialogues with people, with employees, because if you do it later, you just risk ruining your whole business. You have to do it now, you have to take all the confrontations now. I know it's very tough, and we haven't seen this before, which is why we have to do things that we haven't done before. Stay safe and good luck.